14 seconds, guys. Who's the last four more people? Pick your answer. Answer now or forever lose your participation points. Is that how the saying goes? Alright, we're good to go? Alright, next one. Oh, responses. Let's see responses. We can stop the music. All of the above. Okay, 80%. Now, I told you guys I'm looking for a 94. And we do have to compensate for some low numbers the other week. But this looks pretty good. Let's see the answer. Spend time talking about the ones where people don't get it. Good. Okay. So 20% of y'all. We're still right, just not right enough. So that's a good type of question where you can't be, no matter how bad you do, you can't do all wrong, can you? Next one. Huh? E would be all wrong. Total fucking fail. I'm so mean that I even put that E option, right? How do I do that? It's called rigor. The New York radical feminists. Everything sounds more radical when you just add New York in front of it. What reading is this from? This week and last week. It was assigned twice? Same reading as assigned twice? Or are you saying it was addressed in both in two different readings? Right. CRC is it. Last week you did a reading by CRC. This week's reading addressed the CRC. But the NY, or the New York Radical Feminist, was only in this week's reading, right? Yeah. All right, guys, we're done. 85. All right, the rest of y'all, you got 10 seconds. Put in your... Pick something. Gotta pick something. Let's go. What's the answer? Responses? No, 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 don't be correct yet. Come on. Gotta build the suspense. 82. Okay. Okay. Better than 80. A little bit better. Go ahead. Let's see the correct answer. That's got to be the correct answer. Otherwise, we all give up. NYC, New York, saw its target as male chauvinism, which they saw as primarily of psychological origin. This is important. Psychological origin and only secondarily economic. In contrast, is my mic on? In contrast, CRC sought an integrated analysis to oppose racial, sexual, heterosexual, and class oppression simultaneously. What about here? I have a question for you guys. What about national oppression? Did they, if I added national in there as like a contingent thing, did the CRC, obviously by extension, by logical extension, you could say they oppose, they're in favor of immigrant rights, they would oppose discrimination based on national origin or citizenship, you know, through ethical extension. But somebody tell me from your reading, for you recall reading the Combahee River Collective Statement, did they make any mention of that? The Black Power book primarily, you know, the chapters you read talked all about the U.S., specifically in the U.S., but the opening lines of the book say that we analyze and understand Black people as part of what is called the third world. So anything like that in the CRC? I just made up a new exam question. Somebody want to write that down? Dan, you want to write that down? You could say, The CRC, you could just like quote B. You could say, the CRC sought an integral analysis, blah, blah, blah. Did they explicitly oppose discrimination based on national origin or citizenship, or would you say that they oppose it only in the sense of logical, ethical extension, something like that? Less words, you know? Don't you hate those kind of professors, always so wordy? Let's go to, do we have another question? How about we do, that's it. All right, let's lecture. Let us get to the heart of the issue. Let's go. Intersectionality. All right, what is feminism? I don't know that we define feminism yet, which, you know, is important and is debatable. And there's different kinds of feminism, right? Those of us who study feminism. Or is that debatable? Black feminism. What's the distinction between black feminism, white feminism? We talked a little bit about that. It sort of came up in our discussion. Civil rights. What's the distinction between civil rights and black power? Sammy, do you know how many slides I got? Oh, but before that, top hat? We already did top hat. We did it. Come on now. 19? Oh, okay. Oh, good. First week, I didn't put more slides than I could possibly cover. The contradiction that confronts women of color. So what reading is this from? Remember that you guys need to be able to say minimally the last name of the author. Ideally, the full name, but whatever. Last name. So you say, you should know that you read Patricia Hill Collins, or at least Collins, chapter from her book. What's the book called? From Black Power to Hip Hop. And you should know the name of the chapter, because on exams, I could just say, in Collins' reading, which did she say? If you don't remember the names of the authors, if you're just like, well, the reading from week 5, that's not gonna help you on an exam. Or when you talk to people. If you're like, yeah, but don't you guys know, according to the week 5 reading, being interviewed on CNN, they're giving you some bullshit, giving you a neoliberal definition of feminism, and you say, yeah, but remember the reading from week 5? It's too good. I need like an interlocutor here who can like be like, Professor T is clearly weeded. The contradiction that confronts women of color. Feminism, loving ourselves versus nationalism. Note, black nationalism can be understood as a synonym for black solidarity. This is important, so I'm giving you that as an aside. So you've read this chapter from Patricia Hill Collins. She refers a lot throughout the book to black nationalism. Black nationalism also is a philosophy which is alluded to, mentioned, ascribed to, and by in lots of hip-hop lyrics. You could say it's at the core of the philosophy of hip-hop, some version of it. But of course, like all different philosophies, there's many different understandings of it. Different people who ascribe to it have different ideas of what it means, including maybe some interpretations. This is what makes everything infinitely debatable, because there are some people who ascribe to it but define it in a way, in precisely a way that other people who don't ascribe to it would give as the reason for why they don't ascribe to it. Was that too wordy? Do you understand what I mean? Some people would say, I'll give a simple example, not about black nationalism, but feminism. So we could talk about, in African cultural studies, we talk about what is African feminism. Is African feminism significantly different than feminism in general? Anybody ever had that discussion or debate in any African cultural studies classes or gender women's studies classes? So it's a debate. Sometimes when we speak to women activists in different countries in Africa, they don't identify as feminist. They disidentify as feminist. And their reason that they give is because they say, well, we don't want to be labeled with this Western label and all the assumptions and baggage that come along, that comes along with it. So for that reason, they say they're not feminists. Yet, that reason for not identifying as feminist is precisely the reason for which Combahee River Collective and Patricia Hill Collins and others have argued that liberal feminism is problematic and that serious intersectional, substantive, legitimate feminism would be defined in such a way, or should be defined, or should be understood in such a way, so as to include, so as to serve the interest, let me not say include, because it can include anybody who ascribes to it, but so as to address the oppression of all women around the world. See what I did there? That little caveat there? I was going to say apply to, right? But then all women of the world. But then that would mean that you and I, unless we identify as women, we don't get to be feminists. But we're feminists, right? You feminist? Are you an African feminist, though? Because you just say you're African.
I am.
African feminist? I don't know. I just sort of like, see how I asked that question? It's very political.
Yeah.
Like, I made it so it would be very uncomfortable for you to say, I'm not a feminist, bro. What are you talking about?
I mean, I defend women's rights in my country, for example, so I'm not against them. I'm not, like, for oppression or, you know, arranged marriages, that kind of stuff.
Thank you. Now, if you were on Fox News, what he would have said is, I'm not against them, I'm not for them. But he said, I'm not against them, I'm not for oppression. Just these little subtle differences, you know, that make all the difference. By the way, that was a great definition of feminism you just came up with. You should be in my class. Challenge to fuse the two. So, and what's the difference between the definition? Can you hear the difference between the definition that Sammy just freestyled and the definition of feminism that is more mainstream, that's more liberal? The liberal feminism, what is it? It's framed in terms of equality, right? Equality of the sexes. Which, by extent, which you can, you know, depending on how you understand equality, and if we're really talking about equity, and if we're really being intersectional, fine. But if we're defining equality in terms of liberal rights, and we understand liberal rights are negative rights, and we understand it in a civil rights framework, civil rights, rights of citizens, including the rights of American citizens, to vie for the White House and bomb citizens and non-citizens of other countries, you know, if that's the kind of equality that we're talking about, then that doesn't do anything to counter the oppression of the majority of who? Women in the world. In fact, it reinforces the oppression of the majority of women in the world. Therefore, there are versions of the philosophy called feminism and liberalism, and even, very sad to say, it's socialism, that because they are not intersectional, because they are nationalistic, because they are fascistic, which is what nationalism becomes at the extreme. By the way, what do you call the National Socialists? It's fucking Nazi Party, so. Prove my point. That's the math right there, if anybody wrote it out. It's bad news. Okay. Are people following the dots I'm connecting? You guys got questions? Am I going too far afield for people to follow? Let me know.
Like if anything, yeah.
Let's
see, I made these slides. Let's take a look.
That's an excellent question. Because it's like, I'm that kind of dude.
I'm like, yeah, but I gave you the definition. Sure,
you did.
And I'm sure it was a concise definition amidst 900 words delivered in 30 seconds. So look at this nice diagram. Let's talk about intersectionality and the critique offered by intersectionality,
such that feminism, mainstream feminism, which ends up, as we've discussed, because of the way the dynamics of power in human relations are distributed along axes of oppression, it turns out that when women get together, there are certain women, or when women speak out for their interests to be taken into consideration, it turns out that those women who have intersectionally more social power than others, their voices, their concerns tend to drown out the voices and concerns of women who are not so positioned in terms of the social dynamics of power. What's the dynamics of power in social relations? What is that? What's the definition of politics that I gave you? Dynamics of power in human relations or in social relations. That's what politics is. So in any social situation that you find yourself in, to ask yourself that you observe people in or that you find yourself in, if you want to know what are the politics of this situation, if you ask somebody that, go and ask your friend. Go the next time you're in a social situation, which is every second of your life that you're not alone, ask whoever else is in that situation with you, what are the politics of this situation? They'll say, what are you talking about? They'll deny that there is a politics of it. Or they'll say, that's, who could really know? Well, anybody can know if you know what politics actually are. Politics are the dynamics of power in human relations. How is the power distributed in that relationship, in your friend group? Is the power equitable? Is it reasonable? Is it shared? How are decisions made? Are they made in a way that fairly, equitably, adequately addresses the interests and needs and desires and feelings of the people in the situation? Or do some people have a disproportionate or unjust amount of power? Simple.
So, the problem with liberal feminism, as you all have already read, is that it denies, just in that question that we did, which 80% of you guys got, so you know this, right? The problem with, what was it, the New York radical feminists. So they're radical. They're New York. They got to know all this shit. It's cosmopolitan. Everybody's interest, melting pot, what the fuck ever. You know? They ought to know
that these different vectors of oppression, axes of analysis, whatever the fuck you want to call it, these different ways in which people experience oppression, injustice, unfair, what would Barry say? Use Barry's term, what is it? An unjust distribution, an inadequate distribution, a disproportionate distribution of what? Rights, opportunities, and resources. So for the New York radical feminists, their belief is that feminism is that the oppression faced by women is ultimately and only a matter of the ideas of patriarchy, right?
It's a psychological predisposition, character which they call male chauvinism. Male chauvinism is what? The belief that men are superior to women. But they do not consider, their analysis, their theory of the cause, the support, the justification, the underlying material fact of male chauvinism is not explicable in terms of material interests. It just has to do with ideas. It's ideological oppression. Men in general, for some inexplicable reason, just tend to hate women or just think they're inferior. Not because they're socialized into it, because it serves the interests of men in power. Nothing to do with it. So this is, remember I talked to you guys about ideological explanations versus material explanations. But material explanations, like the one Barry gave you, like the theory in Black Power, or the theory in Brian Barry, or the theory in Kumbahi River Collective, these are all materialist theories of understanding justice and injustice. They're material because they argue that oppression should be evaluated and injustice should be evaluated in terms of its material outcomes. And we should analyze it, and we should understand it in terms of the material interests of those who perpetuate it. So, in other words, in Hollywood terms, follow the money. Simple. Why don't you give an example from Africa? Pick up that microphone.
So, for example, in and the airport.
You guys, anytime I'm being too highfalutin theoretical, ask for an example.
Yeah. So, an example of this is when women in Africa, for example, they tend to get unequal inheritance. So, men would get twice as much. So. Two women equal one man, according to that analogy. And a lot of women are fighting back, but it's super hard because it's inscribed in religion. It's like a lot of women are even believers of that. They believe in it. That's the problem.
No, that's an excellent example. And that makes it so much more clear what I was saying. I know I'm giving you guys all these words, idealist versus materialist, but that's a really good example, because especially when you said it's justified in terms of religion, right? So what's the significance of that? That causes women whose interests are undermined by this convention. It's simply a convention, right? But this socially constructed convention wasn't handed down by the gods. I don't think, you don't think. Some people argue it was, right? But that argument is constructed so as to depict this convention, which I believe, Sammy seems to believe, you decide what you believe, this convention which has been created by those with privilege to perpetuate their privilege. So it's political, it's dynamics of power in human relations, but it's not seen as political. It's argued not to be political. It's argued not to be about politics. It's argued to be about what? Religion. So we move it from the sphere of politics to the sphere of religion, or the sphere of culture, and we call it tradition. Well, it's just our tradition, you wouldn't understand. It's just our culture, you wouldn't understand. It's just our gods, you wouldn't understand. Right? So that's how you exercise hegemonic power, control of ideas. Remember that discussion we had where I was trying to tell you guys about Murph trying to beat me up in the parking lot, take my sneakers and shit? Remember that? And I was like, it's not going to last for a long time, because eventually, you know, if you try to impose, if privilege, if oppression is imposed through violence, which it always is, it's always violence in some sense, but if it's physical, overt, direct violence, visible violence, then those whom the violence is being enacted on, like Mobb Deep in that video that we analyzed together, the projects is front line and the enemy is one time. I ain't got to tell you, it's right in front of your eyes. But it's right in front of whose eyes? The relations, the dynamics of power, the relationships of oppression that we live under, the people who are most oppressed in this country and in this world, to them, the people on the base of that pyramid, on which the global pyramid and the national pyramid of wealth is constructed, the people at the base of it feel, experience, see the violence blatantly. It's not covered up. It's not disguised. It's not a microaggression. It's a macro motherfucking aggression. It's a billy club. It's a gun. That's the colonial relation. That's what it's like if you're poor, if you're homeless. Right? That's what it's like if you are in the subworking class. But as you work your way up that pyramid, anywhere where you're not in the 1%, if you're somewhere in the middle, if you're in the middle class, you have some privilege which accrues to you by virtue of that oppression that is happening more overtly below. You get that privilege. Everybody in this room has some privilege which in this system has not accrued to you, to us, simply by merit. That's what we're told. That's what we're led to believe. But the truth is that all of us here, we are, Sammy and I, not excluded. All of us here love that illusion. We love that story. Everything that has accrued to us that's good in our life, that's because we're smart, that's because we're determined, that's because we've worked hard. Everybody who doesn't have this kind of privilege, opposite. Didn't work as hard, didn't study as hard, not as smart, right? That's what, of course we want to believe that, but by believing that, by not recognizing that a lot of this shit was not simply luck, a lot of it is luck, but it's not simply luck. It's contingent on the fact that we behave in ways that perpetuate the privilege of those of us, of those people who are above us on this pyramid of oppression. We have to conduct ourselves in ways that allow this system to perpetuate. That is the bargain, implicit bargain, upon which you are allowed to stay in your position of privilege. Examples. Somebody give me an example. Can anybody think of an example to illustrate what I said? This, what I just said here is not all news to you. This shit some of you have heard before. Maybe there's a few people who are like, what the f- what are you talking about? But, yeah.
For instance, like higher education systems.
And sure, why not?
The idea of there's certain criteria.
We are all benefiting from the higher education system.
Absolutely, and we're fortunate to be a part of it.
Yeah.
But like, for instance, like medical school.
Sorry, what school?
Medical school, okay. Or law school, or really any form of, you know, just higher education, even just college itself. There's certain opportunities given to those who hold more privilege that aren't given to others that allow them to, like, implicitly make their way into these programs, such as, like, volunteering or working for, you know, what you devote your time to extracurricular-wise. Certain people are able to do that because they have the economic means of doing that and not having to be paid for their time and effort, and then therefore are able to get into those systems, as opposed to some people or a majority of people who are forced to work or unable to do certain things because they have other obligations in order to survive in said system, and therefore aren't able to, let's say, get into medical school because they weren't able to volunteer because they had to work, or get into law school because they weren't able to do some sort of unpaid research program because they were forced to work.
Yeah.
So I think that's an example of how it feeds the system, how people who are the children or, you know, like in the upper class, continued wealth continues that way because they're given those opportunities through their familial wealth.
I feel like you've been studying.
A little bit.
Okay, so somebody tell me, which of the theorists that we've studied, thank you, which of the theorists that we studied in this class best illustrates the point that he just made? I can't. The reason why I can't remember your name is because, exactly. Which theorist we studied? Would you, like, so you just heard that. That was very well articulated. So if I asked you, not everybody could necessarily articulate exactly what you, tell me your name?
Nick.
Exactly what Nick said. I never asked your name, did I? Just somebody else. All right, Nick. Little Nicky. So what little Nicky just said, right? I don't imagine everybody could articulate that if you're, obviously, Nick has been studying this stuff for some time prior to taking this class. But you have become acquainted with theorists who have given you the tools to understand better what he said. So prior to taking this class, if you heard somebody say this out on the street or on TV or in a conversation with you, you now should have theoretical tools to understand what he's saying on a different level, in a different way. Could somebody illustrate that? Which theorist could you use to further elaborate or substantiate or understand what Nick said? Yeah, Carly.
I feel like Ryan.
Thank you.
Kind of
okay, let's get the mic and you and tie them together. Yeah.
Okay, so I kind of lost my train of thought. I just remember that it was Brian Berry. Can you re-say what you said? Like, just a little bit?
Yeah, just...
Oh, just the fact that, like, within our system, in order to progress and, like, achieve high levels of economic gain, you have to be born into that. And have those privileges to do certain things that allow you other opportunities. And minorities of people in lower classes aren't given those opportunities, that it's so much more difficult for them to achieve those economic gains.
That's a perfect example to connect with Barry, so go ahead.
So with Brian Berry, he kind of talked about, like, equal rights versus equal opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, we talked about, like, the differences between liberalism and socialism and how one is just equal rights and one is equal opportunities, and that's how I believe that it ties together.
Exactly. That's perfect. Now, I thought you were going to quote KRS-One, and then I was going to do the Brian Berry example, but I guess we could do it the other way.
Sorry.
So, no, it's fine. It's fine. You do next week we could switch. But Carly, what Carly said is perfect, right? So what Nick pointed out is that in terms of access, does every American citizen have the right to go to law school? Are there any laws that say black people can't go to law school? No, there used to be. Are there any laws that say women can't go to law school? No, there used to be. Right? So we have that liberal right in the sense that there is no right prohibiting you on the basis of your identity, on the basis of how your identity is socially constructed, how you are socially positioned in a way that is presented by the ideology to be a permanent factor of your identity. But in truth,
is merely an ideological construct meant to disproportionately distribute rights, opportunities, and resources. So, you remember when I showed you guys the picture of me as a five-year-old in the newspaper? You guys remember that? Now, I and my mom, as you saw, I'm raised by a single mom on welfare. So what class does that put me in, social class? Not all the way up there with my buddies here in the upper class, right? Is that what you said, upper class? Not in upper class. Not in the middle upper class or lower middle class or middle class. Or working class, which everybody has forgotten about, intentionally so, by the ideology of the system. It puts me in the category of quote-unquote poor. It means that I was raised sub-working class. That's the terminology I use. Working class, sub-working class. And generally speaking, people who are sub-working class, as Nick has described, it's not merely economic resources. It's not merely money that is lacking. It means that they are raised under situations of precarity which cause them to, which cause people in general, in the aggregate, under those conditions, lacking those financial resources in their family, in their community, to be able to access not just things that you buy, but immaterial things. Opportunities and resources. Your parents don't have the time to volunteer for the kinds of classes that they want to volunteer for, to hang out in the groups that they want to hang out in, to acquire information, knowledge, et cetera, et cetera. And then they can't pass it on to you. And you don't have those resources. Your parents don't have the time to spend with you that they want to. I'm going to get all choked up here talking about it. But there's something different about this motherfucker, Professor D, I'm telling you. What's the difference? Why is Professor D able to stand on stage with you? Obviously it's because there's no such thing as class. There's no such thing as oppression. That's what the right wing would argue. Obviously, Professor D standing on stage shows that anybody can make it in America. You just gotta work hard. You just gotta be born smart. Right? How are you gonna argue against that? Or is it true? If it's true, we all should fucking leave. What are we doing in this class? There is no social injustice. But what if what Brian Berry said is true? What if the reason why Damon was able to do things that people who are generally in that state of economic oppression, those communities of economic oppression, what if Damon had access to resources like knowledge and information which are generally reserved for people in the middle class or the upper class? What if his mom just happened to be really fucking smart? What if his mom said, you know what, I'm not gonna fucking go work in this factory. I'm not gonna go take the secretary job that they want me to take. I'm gonna be an activist instead. I'm gonna read books instead, and I'm gonna pass this knowledge along. Then Damon is in a very unusual position compared to his peers, because he ends up having these resources that generally people only in the middle class can have. But he also has a perspective that is hidden from people in the middle class. They only get this perspective when they show up in college. And they're reading these books. And they're like, what? Holy shit, my mom told me it was racist? I know, it's out of suspicion about that lady. Or my grandma. Or my aunt. Oh, my dad, my fucking dad, you know. Now, intersect that. What if Damon is a woman? What if Damon is a man of color? What if Damon is a man of color but has light skin privilege? What if he's a light skin presenting motherfucker? All these things come into play with how Damon is able to be at an unusual intersection, which enables him the opportunities and resources to materialize opportunities for himself, to materialize rights and resources for himself in economic terms or in positions that are generally not accessible to people who look like him or talk like him or grow up in the socioeconomic or racial conditions, intersections, subjectivity that he grew up with and as. Everybody following me? So it looks like when you see a black woman at Harvard, you see Jay-Z buying up sports teams, what does Obama say? Obama says, Jay-Z is proof that anyone can make it in America if you try hard enough and sell enough crack. He didn't say the last line. I added that for humor. It was funny. But that's what the fuck he's saying, though. That's how absurd it is. And now put this together, though. This is the critical part. This is the part that makes everything I just said suck. Because, yeah, okay. Maybe Professor D didn't make it onto this stage, and you guys didn't all just make it here simply because of your talents. Doesn't mean D's not talented. Doesn't mean D wasn't smart. Doesn't mean there's not some other people who didn't have these things, right? Okay, I put in the work, no doubt. So did you. I'm not saying you guys didn't work to get here. Of course you did. But I'm just saying that equation, and we all know that their luck played some part. You could name some aspect of luck. But let me give you this analogy to really drive it home for you. Remember that video about how Americans know that economically wealth is distributed in a way that they consider to be unfair. That's true of the majority of Americans. But what's also true is that they do not really know how much more drastically inequitable the reality of the situation is, right? So here's the analogy. Direct analogy. You know that some of the privileges that have accrued to you, that some of the ways you got, some of the things you got in life, some of that is due to luck. But you, for very intentional reasons, have been led to believe, have been indoctrinated. You know, when Sammy said, and then there's women in Africa. He didn't specify the country, just Africa. Unlike most people, he'd be able to say the country if I asked him. But he said, there are women who live in social situations, in countries, in polities, where, in communities, where it is understood as normal, as reasonable, as logical, as fair, as just, as beyond question, where it's just reasonable that men, of course men are going to get double the inheritance. The gods said so, right? And when I said that, you all thought, that shit is crazy. Everybody thought that. I wouldn't believe that shit. How can they be so ridiculous? Believe that the gods said so. right? That's what you think. But you believe, you, for the identical reasons, believe that the majority of good things that have happened in your life are because of your own agency. And the majority of bad things that happen to that shit was other people's fault. That shit was bad luck. But the good things that happened to you and your family, mostly, that was because they worked hard, right? Well, if you believe that, you may as well believe that the God said that 50% of us should get double the inheritance that the other 50% get. Equally logical. And equally implausible when you consider what's the alternative. What is the alternative? The alternative is that these conventions, these dynamics of power, these relationships of power, these identities that we have and are ascribed to us, and we are told you're born with this identity, nobody made it up, you can't change it, you have to behave this way because this is your identity. Why are you acting like somebody you shouldn't be acting like? Why are you acting like a boy when you should be acting like a girl? Or vice versa. Why are you not acting the way your racial designation is supposed to behave? What is wrong with you? And then the person says, look, this is not my opinion. This is nobody's decision. This is just the way things are. But the alternative is that it is the way things are. It's a material fact of our social condition. It's a reality which is constructed to distribute rights, opportunities, and resources to privilege some people at the expense of others. So when I said the thing that makes my story suck about how Professor D got here is that it's not simply that, not just, okay, maybe it's 50%, maybe 60% luck, 40% hard work. The other part of what I told you, which you've conveniently forgotten about, is that in order for us to be here, we are participating. We are legitimating in ways that we want to, that our subconsciousness wants to hide from us. And that is that we are complicit in perpetuating the privilege for those of us higher on this pyramid. We have to conduct ourselves in ways that do not fundamentally threaten the bargain that the ruling class has made with the middle class, which is to keep the situation more or less the way it is. Make sure that we as the middle class or the intelligentsia don't destabilize things such that the distribution of rights, opportunities, and resources becomes truly equitable. And if you do that, what happens? You could be the leader of a social movement with great prestige. You get exiled. You get shot. You could be a professor of African cultural studies. And there could be those who do everything they can to try to get you the fuck up out of that situation. If you're doing things that too fundamentally threaten the natural order. I'm not saying who this is just hypothetical. So what's the connection here, right? The connection to feminism, from feminism to black feminism, is based on the critique that feminism to court was default, even though it wasn't saying so, If it's just feminism and there's no such thing as race, or everybody in the group doesn't see race, quote unquote, right? If that's the case, then what happens? Those who are positioned in a way where they have racial privilege, their interests are going to be represented and others are not. That's the fundamental critique of that black feminism initially, right? Initially, black feminism, black feminists, women who happen to be black in these, joined these feminist groups and found out, hey, something funny is going on here, right? Somehow, the analysis, it's like just nobody's thinking about class. It's all just ideological. It's all just, men just dislike us for some reason. Men just don't want us to also, you know, be CEOs exactly like them. And then some of the women in the group were like, yo, we don't, none of the guys we know are CEOs. You know? Wait a sec. Something is afoot. It's the thing in your mouth, lady. What did one feminist say to the other? Okay. Right, so that's the critique. And the critique starts there, as was explained in this sort of genealogy that you got. It starts with what's the most obvious, what's the most visible, what's the most tangible barrier to solidarity among the 99% or the working class. The most visible is race, right? But then you start to like look further. How come there's no material analysis with respect to class? Okay, we know why race, because white women are there, they're privileged by race, their interests somehow supersede. What about class? Okay, women with class privilege, in the way we've just discussed, their interests, because of the resources, the schooling, the opportunities they've had, they're able to mobilize resources, articulate their ideas, argue for their position, dominate the conversation, dominate the agenda, not intentionally, sometimes intentionally, but we all do this. We all perform our socialized identities in ways that we are unconscious of for the reasons I've described. So black feminism then realizes, this is what Combahee River Collective was clear about in their statement. And this is the genealogy, the history that Patricia Hill Collins gave you in her chapter that you read this week, From Black Power to Hip Hop. She explained that it started out where black women activists were going to these meetings, right? With black men who are mobilizing for racial justice, right? For civil rights. Maybe it's on the next slide. So I got, what do we got here? Civil rights block. See if you know how following me. Oh, music video. I was watching music video. So. Let me finish the thought. Let me finish the point. So you can leave it on the next slide. Yeah, okay. Feminism to black feminism, right? I explain. And from there, it snowballs. From there, they realize, wait a second, aren't we still in the, what was, then there was the National Black Feminist Organization. So National Black Feminist Organization is the first organization that's created to deal with these, with the way that the National Feminist Organization is not addressing race. So then you get the National Black Feminist Organization. Then what happened there? Then women who were there in the National Black Feminist Organization recognized that the women, everybody's black, the women with class privilege seem to be dominating the agenda. What's going on here? Right? And then they realize, oh, the women with cisgender privilege are dominating once we take class into consideration. So that's how you develop intersectional analysis. And that's why the most important sentence conceptually for you to understand, I told you from the CBC statement, is that if black women were free, all people would be free. It doesn't mean if middle class black women were given privilege in the same way white middle class women are given privilege, everybody would be free. That's not what it means. It means that if you follow the logic, it means that if you are ethically consistent, it means that you have a proper materialist analysis where you see how privilege at all levels and in all ways is contingent on disadvantage. Exists in a, who does a little math, right? Inversely proportionate relationship to the distribution of disadvantage. I could be up here like doing my equations. Freak a lot of motherfuckers out. Carly, just before we watch the video, Carly, I thought you were going to quote, you know, or you were going to quote KRS-One when you were talking about the law school stuff, right? I know you were thinking it. I'll remind you guys, the people who didn't listen to KRS-One's album, Sex and Violence. Everything you learn in law school can be taught when you're 6 years old. But they make you wait and wait and wait and wait and wait. And of course, the information is then sold. But what if you can't afford to pay? You walk around ignorant all day. The pimp don't care. It's really your decision. Kick up that money, ho. Oh, I mean tuition. They be dissing. They ask you be kissing. Sitting in a room with a liar. And you must listen. Let's watch a video. Oh, this motherfucker. Okay, hold on. I gotta say this. Wait, go back to the other slide. Okay, trigger warning, anybody? Everybody? It's a little, let me give you a trigger warning. I told you this whole class, you know, it's a trigger. We're dealing with serious issues. Okay, so black feminists, we talked about how they go to these meetings with feminist activists. I said that part of the story. Then what happens? Then they go to this, to the meetings with black nationalists, right, which is in the lingo of the time, means black power activists, people who are advocating for racial justice against black oppression, right? They go there, what happens? Everything sounds great, everybody's on board, until they start to realize, wait a sec, the men here seem to not really be considering the specific issues that are disproportionately affecting black women. Let's see if you can say, see, let's see if you can say why I made sure I said that before we watched this video. Let's go. This is the big homie King Son.
Times, and if you don't want to hear it, then pay it no mind. What I'm about to say may get you all upset, so I apologize, and the wise don't sweat. The matter at hand is toward the black. They live a falsehood life, and that's no way to act. You don't wear gold because you can't afford it. The medallion was cheap, so you went out and bought it from a Chinese man or some Korean fella. I bet you think your money went to help Mandela. Oh, really? Has the past been forgotten? Dressing how they used to in the days of picking cotton. Martin Luther King did a rock. The back of the bus. I study 120. I'm writing it, so I think I should reveal what it is to be black. Now everybody's wearing the red, black, and green. Here's the point. Do you know what it means? Red for the bloodshed, black for the people, green for the land to be utilized equally. Boy, you're just a faker. Name one city. An American name. You might fool others, but you can't fool son. Wanna build with a brother? Then I am.
question, my brother, man. You can't even do the right things for self. Then you got the nerve to criticize somebody else. If it wasn't for Chuck, you wouldn't know of Farrakhan. I understand that the man is a paragon. Open up your eyes and ears and try to learn. Stop perpetrating with your false concern. Even some rappers ending their videos, nothing but Oreos, trying to be memorial. I'm not impressed by the way some stars perpetrate to be original. You know who you are. I diss my people who choose to lack, cause there's more to learn on how to be black.
Sound good so far? Check it out.
And then they say I'm prejudiced because I like red bones. But nowadays, original girls are headstrong. Not as a whole, but the majority I know are too busy fronting, yo. Trying to be fly, though. You might hear this and think I'm tripping. But knowledge your wisdom before you start flipping. As modern day God, I do analysis. Find out what makes them hard like calluses. Instead of being sweet, truthful, and soft, they want to be false, and that turns me off. Your hair's not real. Neither are your eyes, and your makeup is swine, plus a bit of disguise. Your clothes are tight, I can see every inch, and then you wonder how I get this urge to pinch. Selling you sex without making love, I'm not keep to be sweating you, and that's unheard of. If I got dollars, I'm good for your number. If I look fine, I get a one-night slumber. Wham, bam, but no thank you, man. Wanna knock the boots, but you don't know who I am. This is not a diss to my black sister. If I screamed on your daughter, pardon me, mister. The point I make is such a bitch. How to be original and how to be black.
I'm a black man. I'm a black man. I'm a black man. I'm a black man.
Black, 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 black. Groove to this. Move to this.
I know, I'm sorry. I thought it was really... This is a song, right? I don't know, just anything. I was just trying to kind of taking it in and kind of like.
Did you hear? I told everybody I won't put you guys on the spot. Remember that?
No, yeah.
So we remind everybody of your name.
My name is Rocky.
Yeah, so put a name like that. You know she got something to say. You know. Rocky, did you read the first. The first two verses in any way different than the last one?
I mean,
let me just say, I understand everybody can't follow all the words, right? So, but yeah. But did you notice a difference?
I mean, obviously, yeah, and then obviously it then applies to women.
Let's not say obvious because some people could have missed it.
To me.
Yeah.
No, obvious to me. Yeah. So to me, obviously it was different between the first two, talking about, you know, what it means to be black and then him talking about women. Mm. So, I...
What was it saying about women?
Just that they put on a front with the fake hair and the makeup and, like, just trying to get at you instead of being more gentle and laid back.
Mm-hmm. The way women are supposed to be.
Yeah.
Now, was he just talking about all women?
With context to what the first two verses, I believe he was only talking or alluding to only African-American or black women.
Yeah. So the first two verses is all about black solidarity, black nationalism, and then the last verse is everything wrong with black women. Anybody else want to add anything? What else? Anything else you noticed in the video you want to comment on? Go ahead, Ann. Talked enough. Nobody else? I mean, whatever. You don't have to. Really? Did you love the video? Did you hate the video? Whatever. Couldn't understand any of it. What's your reaction?
Yeah, like... No, but actually, I want to know, like, you know, it's hard for me. I can't really know. Things that are obvious to me is not obvious to you. Things that are obvious to you, not obvious to me. You guys know the names, all kinds of weird little rappers I never heard of. I expect you guys to explain that shit to me. If I'm showing you these old motherfuckers,
And you're like, I don't understand what the fuck he's talking about. You got to tell me that. I'll break it down. But I think, I mean, there's millions of examples like this. But I just, the reason why I showed this one is because I just feel like the juxtaposition is so stark. Let's go to the next video. You know, it's black, go back 1 second. Just like black nationalism without what? Right? Without black feminism, without intersectionality, without a gender critique, without a recognition of the way that, well, you are promoting, well, you're all about black solidarity, black knowledge, black consciousness, knowing the countries in Africa, of which Jamaica is not one. You know, he's so witty when it comes to talking about black shit. And then all of a sudden, except black women shit, right? Then all of a sudden, sounds like just a regular patriarch, right? But not just a regular patriarch, but it is significant because he isn't just saying women in general. He's saying, I particularly happen to find dark-skinned black women to be a problem. I'm not prejudiced, I'm just saying. Lighter-skinned girls seem to behave better. That's what the fuck he said. It's fucked up. It's fucked up. This guy I respect in a lot of ways. Let's go. But not in that way. Okay, so what is feminism? Let's go to the next slide. End to gender oppression, right? This is how I recommend that you understand these things. How many slides we got left? Yeah, we'll end on this. Let's talk about, this is what I want to say. Is like, this is how liberalism, this is how the liberal university, this is how the university that we're in talks about diversity without talking about oppression, right? There is no, we can have multiculturalism, we can have diversity. What is diversity? How's the university define diversity? Go look it up. In whatever way is the broadest possible with the least actual consequences to bring about any kind of real justice. With the least possible way that you could mobilize that definition to do something to actually change the distribution of rights, opportunities, and resources as they already are distributed. It's defined in a way so as to make sure that the colonial situation that created this university in the first place, that created these identities which we all still project onto one another, and they are real. Don't in any way get the impression I'm saying we're projecting the shit so it's not real. It's real. Why is it real? Because people die as a result. People go to the ancestral realm as a result. And then they talk to the gods and find out it was a lie the whole fucking time that they didn't get an equal amount of inheritance. I'll talk to you guys.